Hello science fans, welcome to Sciencia. Our video today is about innovation. It's day 4 of a week-long set of class suspensions in Metro Manila as a preemptive measure to control the spread of COVID-19 in the city. We were supposed to have our second DLSU Senior High School Research Congress today, and this video is about the plenary talk I prepared for our students. I gave my presentation the title Innovation for Dummies, mostly because a lot of us are actually innovating without being aware that we are doing it. It will tell you about my 12-year journey as a scientist and how innovation has been part of some of the key aspects of my professional life. I was recently in a radio talk show called Pinoy Scientists, hosted by Dr. Custer De Ocarius. I mostly talked about CraviFire, a technology that our team has developed and is currently deploying nationwide. But through the course of our discussions, he noticed that I came from such a varied set of disciplines. And this was interesting because traditionally, scientists would stick to a specialization and keep to it until they retire. This inspired me to focus my talk on these points of innovation that changed my life through the course of my 12 years as a scientist. Throughout my journey as a scientist, I noticed that innovation often comes when we need it, usually when we have limited resources or if we are challenged with new situations. It often combines information, imagination, and initiative to create something new and useful from what already exists. Innovation, however, can also be intimidating because sometimes it just feels like everything that needs to be done has been done before. Take, for example, the movies. If you look at the plot of Aladdin and Les Miserables, you'll notice that it starts with a protagonist who steals a loaf of bread and becomes imprisoned because of it. They then meet someone who gives him riches, and then they go against the current political government of the society that they're in, and eventually, they force the antagonist to defeat himself. It's a story that's been told before, but in different innovative ways. Another popular story that has been told repeatedly is that of a foreigner going to a new land where he meets the natives. And initially, his intent is to help acquire the resources of that land for his own people. Eventually, he falls in love with the way of life and maybe a particular lady in that land also, and this leads him to have a change of heart. This eventually leads him also to help these natives to protect their land against those who would plan to take advantage of them. Several times, in fact, this one has already 4 movies, perhaps more, about that same topic. And I think this one is the most popular. You have a single father whose child was abducted and he goes through so many dangerous situations just to rescue him. Who would have thought that Finding Nemo and Taken is basically the same story? So, as Stanley Kubrick, the director of 2001 A Space Odyssey and The Clockwork Orange, has eloquently said, everything has already been done before. Every story has been told, every scene has been shot, but it is our job to make it better. And that, for me, is at the heart of innovation. As scientists, we find ourselves standing on the shoulders of giants, and this can be pretty intimidating. If you look at the scientific breakthroughs in 2019, it's hard to think of what else we can do that's new and innovative. However, this is also a pretty exciting challenge. My journey as a scientist began with abaca and Dr. Vermando Aquino. Abaca is an interesting plant because it is one of the key exports of the Philippines. The fibers that come from this plant are known for their strength, reliability, and durability. They are in fact the most common component of paper money, envelopes, and ropes. These ideal qualities of Philippine abaca was created through the process of selective breeding. In a nutshell, selective breeding is choosing 2 plants that have preferred characteristics and allowing them to breed together so that your next population will be better than the last. This involves genetic engineering at its most traditional sense because it creates a recombination of genes that would not otherwise happen naturally. Recently, however, our farms have been disrupted because of the abaca bunchy top virus. As the name suggests, it causes the plants to become bunchy or smaller in size. This also leads to the fibers to becoming brittle and hard to use. The only way to stop the virus from spreading is to destroy the infected plants. And this has led a lot of losses in our abaca industry. The lab of Dr. Vermando Aquino from the National Institute of Molecular Biology and Biotechnology embarked in a project that involves DNA editing in order to create a variety of abaca that is immune to the virus. Now, even though this seems intimidating, DNA editing is actually an innovation on selective breeding. This time though, the gene edits that we are making is more precise and targeted because it involves the transfer of one gene at a time. Contrary to selective breeding, where you are creating a mishmash of the genetics of two different organisms and more. So selective breeding is often a hit or miss, whereas gene editing is more accurate and precise. For my undergraduate thesis, I was tasked by the team of Dr. Aquino to work on the optimization of gene editing techniques for abaca. This was needed because during that time, most of the gene manipulation techniques were optimized for dicots, but abaca was a monocot. This implies that whenever the tissue of abaca was damaged, it undergoes a process called lignification. The method that I tried to optimize was called the gene gun or the biolistics machine. I shot microscopic pellets made of gold that was covered with DNA into the tissue of the abaca plant, hoping that the new DNA that was present in the bullets would eventually be expressed with the plant. This technique that I developed, and also the new DNA designed by the team of Dr. Aquino, allowed us to be successful in reaching our goals. After completing this very interesting thesis, however, the world changed its point of view about genetic modification. All of a sudden, GMOs, or genetically modified organisms, are scary products instead of amazing innovations. At this point, I didn't know what to do with what I learned. So I decided to learn something new. I transitioned into environmental science and management. My specialization was upland rehabilitation and management. And here I experienced going into the field, going into mountains, and going into coastal communities. I started talking to people instead of just working in the lab. I experienced replanting trees and mangroves. I talked to teachers about how to improve environmental education for children. But one of the key aspects that I learned here through the team of Dr. Innocencio Buot was working with indigenous peoples. Traditional ecological knowledge management systems is as far away as you can get from molecular biology. Instead of working in the lab and focusing on the DNA, I started to look at what people were doing, how they were treating each other, and how they were treating the environment. But one unique thing about TEKM is that instead of using modern technology, I was looking at indigenous practices of different groups of people and how these can be validated so that we can actually promote using them instead of the newer things that we have designed. It looks at the intersection of the past and the present in order to find the best means that would allow for sustainability. The keystone project that I did for my master's study was a work with the Eva Aitas in Oryon, Bataan. Their land became degraded because of unsustainable practices that they learned from the lowlanders. Through the project, we were able to go through their traditional practices and sift out which ones we can use to help rehabilitate their land. Now, they have an agroforest of mangoes interspersed with other flowering trees that can help them sustain their daily lives. We've also found a means for them to finally get the land certificate of their land so that they are now the formal owners. Now, while I was taking up my master's, I was continuously teaching at the De La Salle University. However, since I was only a master's graduate, my tenure or place within the university is still not secured. I needed to get my PhD. At that point, however, I have not raised enough money to fund my own education, and at the same time, my mother was getting sick, and she didn't want me to leave the country to study abroad. I really didn't know what to do. But I guess sometimes when you need it, life finds a way to help you. And here I met Dr. Menchie Lagman. Dr. Menchie Lagman was a colleague at the biology department of De La Salle University. She was as new to the university as I was, but she had a new USAID NSF project on the population genetic structure of five different organisms. This project interfaced with five different institutions in the Philippines, which included UPMSI, NFRDI, UP Mindanao, and Siliman University. Because of my background in both molecular biology and also environmental science, she tapped me to be one of her research associates to help her in identifying and studying different characteristics of the mud crab, Sila serrata. My time under Dr. Menchie Lagman began my PhD journey. Apart from studying the population genetic structure of mangrove crabs, I also learned that species identification for this organism was not so simple. So I started working on species identification of adults. But as I went on the field and talked to fishermen, the way I used to talk to people during my master's, I realized that they had a bigger problem, which is species identification in juveniles. Here, we started doing something we never planned on doing, and this started the Crabbyfire journey. Crabbyfire was built on the knowledge that mangrove crab farms in the Philippines have limited resources, and in order to maximize them, the fisher should be able to choose the species that they want to grow. And the species that was preferred is Sila serrata, the king mangrove crab, because of its capacity to grow bigger and faster compared to the others. However, at that point, no morphological means of species identification was available for juveniles. I knew how to identify them using molecular techniques, but I wanted to see if I can find a morphological counterpart to the molecular identification that I was doing. So to proceed with this, I did a lot of image analysis on thousands of pictures of juvenile mangrove crabs, and lo and behold, I was able to find distinct characteristics at the frontal lobe spines, or the crown, of the juvenile crabs. For us, this was such a simple innovation, but it earned us an Outstanding Research and Development Award for Emerging Technologies at the 2015 Pisherd Awards. This was such a great honor for us, and it allowed us to continue on this development. We teamed up with members of the DLSU College of Computer Studies, Ms. Courtney Ann Ngo and Ms. Cheska Laguna, in order to transform our semi-automated method of species identification into a fully automated mobile application called Crabbyfire. Crabbyfire makes use of convoluted neural networks to sift through the features of the dorsal carapace of the crab in order to find the key features that helps in species identification. This was all done through a DOST PICAARD project that Dr. Menchie Lagman is leading. As a PhD graduate, now I am leading my own project. We are now in the process of deploying Crabbyfire, apart from other technologies, nationwide. And we are hoping to create a network of stakeholders that makes use of this technology and evaluates its functionality and effectiveness. The CrabTech team is made up of a dynamic group of people with mixed backgrounds. We have biologists, educators, computer scientists, and programmers in our team. We've also expanded by tapping social workers as well as marine biologists in helping us find the best places to put Krabby Fire and to put crab farms all over the country. We are currently at the third quarter of the first year of our project. So far, we've continuously worked in the lab, but also on the field. But as we deployed the app through different places in the Philippines, we found ourselves being challenged on how to communicate the science behind Krabby Fire. Some of our key challenges were in developing materials that would help fishermen, traders, and monitoring agencies learn about the capacities of Krabby Fire. We had to learn about the best way to say a particular message, to say it in a particular language, and also to make sure that nobody is offended by the technology we've created. You see, what's dangerous about what we did is that fishermen have been doing what they've been doing for decades. We've only been doing this for a couple of years. If you talk to them wrong, they might get the impression that we feel that we're better than them or that we're doing something that they don't know about. So as part of our project, we also do focus group discussions that encourage them to share to us local practices that we can validate and also help share with other communities. Our challenges in communicating the essence of this technology to different stakeholders all over the country has reignited my passion for science communication. And for my recent innovation, I have started a science blog called She Ensha, which gives a voice to different science developments all over the world in the perspective of a Filipina scientist. This is now available in sheensha.wordpress.com, and I'm also just started this YouTube channel. So it's been a crazy adventure so far, but honestly, I think this roller coaster of craziness is at the heart of innovation. At its core, I believe that innovation is about talking to people, being in touch with current events, thinking of new ways to do classical things, and creating something that is cheaper, faster, and better. At its heart, it is the democratization of knowledge and technology so that more people can live a more efficient and sustainable life. I hope that you were able to enjoy this video. Please visit again every once in a while so that you can see the latest updates of She Ensha. Please don't hesitate to comment at the comment box below and let me, your resident Filipina scientist, know about your thoughts. Apart from this, please remember, when in doubt, always use your conscience. Thank you so much. Have a nice day.